Hey everyone, welcome to DomTime. Has anybody out there, anybody watching tonight, not heard the expression stand your ground? If you haven't, my goodness, where have you been? Have you been on vacation? Have you been stranded in a cave somewhere? We're going to talk about that tonight because it's still very much in play coming off the Trayvon Martin case. And right here in Pennsylvania, we have an expansion of the so-called Castle Doctrine. I would call it a mini version of stand your ground. Many states have something like this. And we have two great guests tonight with a lot of information and different perspectives on stand your ground, self-defense, gun rights. Joining us again for a second time here is Shira Goodman. Shira is the director, executive director of Ceasefire Pennsylvania. And Jonathan Goldstein is a firearms attorney out there in Montgomery County who's been with me on the radio. Thank you both for coming in tonight.
Thanks for having us.
Well, I'm looking at this continuation, Shira, and I know there's a lot of energy now around stand your ground, et cetera. Eric Holder, Attorney General in Orlando, said that stand your ground senselessly expands the concept of self-defense and sows dangerous conflict in our neighborhoods. I don't see it that way, but do you see it that way?
Well, when this came up in Pennsylvania, starting in around 2010, and then it passed in 2011, Ceasefire PA said, we don't think we need this. We listened to the district attorneys and police who said traditional self-defense is working for people who have found the need to resort to deadly force. We don't really need this expansion. And we also took the position, we think it's going to embolden people to take risks they don't need to take. Now that you don't have to retreat from a dangerous situation before resorting to deadly force, people
why should you have to? I would ask you that point by question. Why should I, if I'm lawfully here in the studio, a mall, whatever, and I have a right to carry legally, I'm doing everything legally, why should I have to retreat?
Because if you can get away safely, why should you escalate a situation that doesn't need to be? I mean, I don't think anybody, you know, lawfully carrying or not, wants to engage and have to fire their weapon at somebody else. I would ask Jonathan that question. But I think that the safer and more prudent course is if you can retreat without escalating the situation, you should. What stand your ground laws do is they say you don't have to anymore, and I think it emboldens people to take risks they might not otherwise take. People then assume that other people are armed, and we are seeing in other states that conflicts are rising. We haven't had a horrible case in Pennsylvania yet. The DAs have said this is traditional self-defense. Those laws were working. We didn't need
this. Now, Jonathan, I'd ask you this. In Florida, here's part of the template coming up, what Shira said. We have a dead teenager, national tragedy. And we have a guy who allegedly, even though I don't think the jury believed that, was stalking him or going toward him or provoking him. When things go awry that he's being beaten up, he kills him. And stand your ground was not used in the trial, though we may debate that a little bit. But it's a backdrop in Florida and other states, a presumption that helped a guy like Zimmerman.
So, you know, I don't know what happened really in Florida. Right. I think the jury looked at that and the jury did what the jury did. But here in Pennsylvania, you know, the stand your ground law represents the radical notion that good people shouldn't have to retreat when attacked by bad people.
But why? Why escalate? Shira's right. Why cause and why do you have to do that?
So what Shira calls an escalation, I just call a good person being where he has a right to be. And if you're not doing anything wrong and you're carrying a firearm lawfully, legally, as you indicated, you shouldn't have to flee in the face of
you prevent the use of that weapon. Isn't that what the purpose is? If you're law-abiding and carrying a weapon, you don't want to use it.
No, I mean, who wants to shoot anybody? It's a terrible
weapon. So why not flee then?
Well, if you can remember, the law prior to stand your ground was that you had to be able to flee in absolute safety. That was what the law called for. Rare is the circumstance when you can flee in absolute safety. For example, in an interior space in a home, absolute safety means that the attacker is more than 21 feet from you.
But that's not fair. You never had the duty to retreat in your home.
You had the duty to retreat in absolute, if you could do so in absolute safety.
But not in your own home.
And tell viewers, though, why the 21 feet?
So we have a drill that we do. If you ever take, I'm also an NRA certified instructor. And if you ever take a safety course that we teach, and we teach lots of them, you will find that was a drill called the Twiller drill, where we did a lot of experiments and figured out this is the distance at which an attacker, if he's any closer than 21 feet, can lay his hands on you before you can unholster a firearm and fire it twice.
Yeah, and Shira, I'd ask you, why do I have to go through all these calculations? I'm at risk, maybe my wife, child, somebody's at risk. Why would I have to go through all that? Just stand your ground, and if the person will not relent, use deadly force. What's wrong with that?
Well, I just think that, you know,
I think in those moments, it is hard to make those calculations. Mm-hmm. I think you're right, and I think the instinct should be, can I get to safety? Am I endangering other people? I mean, it's not so easy just, and as Jonathan will tell you, you know, he's talking about this 21-foot right. distance to know who you're shooting, to are you getting the right person, are you getting the right mm-hmm. aim, are you trying to protect other people? Why do all those calculations if you can get away? I mean, what if you're in a car and you can get away safely? Why then bring this on yourself, shoot somebody else, possibly kill someone when you didn't really have to?
Okay, let me ask one other question, too. You have information, and I don't want to forget it. You contend that Stand Your Ground was at play in the trial. I would say I see no evidence of that.
So
what evidence is there in Florida?
The evidence is the jury instructions. So, okay. And that is really where it came into play. He didn't plead it as an affirmative defense. It didn't lead to that. But the instructions that the jurors received were that if George Zimmerman was not engaged in an unlawful activity and was mm-hmm. attacked in any place he had a right to be, and he had no duty to retreat and had the right to stand his ground and meet force with force, including deadly force, if he reasonably believed it was necessary to do so to prevent death or great bodily harm, the danger facing George Zimmerman need not have been actual. That is what was said. Before Stand Your Ground, the jury would have heard, the defendant cannot justify the use of force likely to cause death or great bodily harm unless he used every reasonable means within his power and consistent with his own safety to avoid the danger before resorting to that force. The fact that the defendant was wrongfully attacked cannot justify his use of force likely to cause death or great bodily harm if by retreating he could have avoided the need to use that force.
Okay, so Jonathan, there is some evidence that some of the jurors maybe took this into account, this backdrop of Stand Your Ground, even though he never used it as a defense in their instructions. They got into this gray area, and they had to go with Zimmerman based on that.
So, you know, I don't want to get too wrapped around the axle about the Zimmerman trial
right.
because I don't know the facts that well, and I don't practice in Florida. But I can tell you that here in Pennsylvania, the law is working. We don't have a case where we've had anything.
How long has the expanded castle doctrine
years.
Been?
Years.
Two
plenty
years.
Of time. Years.
Two
plenty
years.
Of time
okay,
for us.
2 years.
Plenty of time. Plenty of time okay. where if we were
I like
have,
that. Years. That is 2 years.
It's 2 years.
It's
right.
two.
This guy's a lawyer.
Right.
There you
yeah.
go.
Yeah.
Exactly. Right. All right. So 2 years, and we haven't seen any of these egregious cases.
We haven't
cases.
Seen it abused.
But DAs are against it. I've had several on the show with me saying, drug gangs are going to use it. People that are criminals are going to use it.
Sure.
Well, they
I
did
mean,
put things in our law that make it better than Florida.
It's reasonably balanced. You have to see a weapon in order to invoke in under our statute. I have the statute with
you
me.
You can't use it against a police officer
who's no, you can't.
Lawfully doing their duty. So the DAs
correct.
Did end up being more neutral. But if you ask them, they will say the traditional laws of self-defense were working. We didn't
okay.
need this, and we haven't needed it.
Coming up for both you guys, and we want to take calls at home, something you may not have heard about under the Florida Stand Your Ground. Who is invoking that? Who's using it? And it plays right into the whole Trayvon Martin case. That's straight ahead on DomTime.